students, now in this module we'll be seeing about the active optical components and the tunable light sources. So your active optical components are nothing but the components, optical components which require some external energy to perform their function there. So when an external energy is going to be applied to the active components, they can be electronically tuned. So in that case, they can be used for a greater application. There is a flexibility in operation of the active components there. So we say that active components, some types of external energy is going to be required to perform their functions. So, or it can be used for wider range of operations than passive devices, and it is going to have greater flexibility there. So the applications where these active components are going to be used is in variable optical attenuators, tunable optical filters, dynamic gain equalizers, optical add or drop multiplexers, polarization controllers and dispersion compensators. These are the devices where your active components are going to be used. So here in this case, many active optical components use the MEMS technology. So here we are going to see a simple example of a MEMS actuation method where we are going to have the miniature devices. So MEMS technology, we know that it is going to be a consist of miniature devices, where these miniature devices is nothing but a combination of mechanical, electrical, optical components. So which is going to provide the sensing and actuation functions there. So this MEMS technology is going to be fabricated. So these devices are going to be fabricated using your IC compatible batch processing techniques, and the size is going to be, range of the size is going to be from micro to millimeters. So now the MEMS technology, and I'm going to see the active device, the construction of the device is going to be in such a way that we are going to have a suspended polysilicon beam over the silicon ground plane there. So when this suspended polysilicon beam is going to be over the silicon ground plane, now over this silicon ground plane, I'm going to have a dielectric insulator. So to this dielectric insulator, here now this technology, to the silicon ground plane, we are going to connect the positive of the voltage, and to the suspended polysilicon beam, we are going to connect the negative voltage there. So here there is going to be a space between the dielectric insulator and the suspended polysilicon beam. So around 0.6 micrometer is going to be the space that is going to be between this insulator and the suspended polysilicon beam there. So initially, when I'm not going to apply any voltage, that means the voltage is going to be zero, there's going to be a space of 0.6 micrometer is going to be maintained. Suppose when I'm going to apply an voltage which is going to be greater than zero, in that case what happens is the suspended polysilicon beam bends because of the force what we are going to apply here. It bends and it touches the dielectric insulator. So now this is going to form a device. So here now we are going to have the silicon ground plane. This is going to be a polysilicon beam, which is going to be bent, and this is your dielectric insulator. So now we say that at the top of the device, we are going to have a suspended polysilicon beam, where the polysilicon beam is going to be of length, width and thickness of dimensions 80, 10 and 0.5 micrometer. So at the bottom, we are going to have a silicon ground plane which is going to be covered by the insulator material, that is a dielectric insulator. So when an voltage is going to be applied between the silicon ground plane and the polysilicon beam, the electric force is going to pull the beam down, and it is going to have the contact with the lower structure there. So when the electric force is going to be used to bend or deflect one of the MEMS layer to produce the desired mechanical motion, then in that case, if I'm going to use stiffer materials, the stiffer materials are going to require higher voltage to give this mechanical deflection there. So now to reduce the required forces, we are going to use the current MEMS technology which are going to be used, is going to use compliant polymetric materials there. So this class of components are going to be called as CMEMS, that is compliant MEMS technology. So where this technology is going to employ a soft rubber like material called an elastomer. So next device, what active device we are going to see is your variable optical attenuators. So in a variable optical attenuators, we are going to have the active signal level is going to be controlled by the proper operation of your DWDM networks there. So here in this case, all the wavelength channels which are going to exist in the optical be excited out of an optical amplifier should have a gain of same level there. So in that case, when I'm going to have this operation, there are chances of a certain channel can be blanked out to perform the network monitoring there. Or we can go for span balancing, where it is going to see that all the signal strengths at the user location are going to be of same value there. And next is signal attenuation. So signal attenuation is attenuation should be reduced, or it should have an attenuation circuit at the receiver so that it will prevent the photodetector saturation there. So here, what are the wavelengths that are going to exit, wavelength channels that are going to exit at the output of an optical amplifier need to have the same gain level. It should have certain channel spacing, then span balancing, then you are going to have your signal attenuation there. So here your variable optical attenuator is going to provide dynamic. So variable name itself tells it is going to have a dynamic signal control levels there. So when it is going to have a dynamic signal level controls, we can see that the device is going to attenuate this optical power there. So how this device is going to attenuate the optical power is by means of the control signal levels. So here in this case, with the help of the control signal levels, without disturbing the properties of the light signal, we are going to attenuate the optical power there. So here in this case, the device what we are going to use should be polarization independent, and it should attenuate the light independent of the wavelength, and it should have a low insertion loss. The properties that the device should have is it should be polarization independent, attenuate light independent of the wavelength, and it should have a low insertion loss there. So the control methods, so what are the control methods that is going to include is mechanical, thermo-optic, MEMS or electro-optic techniques there. So when I'm going to go for a mechanical control method, that mechanical control method is going to be a reliable one, and it is going to have a low dynamic range and a slow response time is going to be expected. If I go for a thermo-optic method, in that case I'm going to have a high dynamic range and it is going to be slow, and it is going to require the use of a thermocouple electric cooler, which is not desirable then. So here the next is we are going to go for a tunable optical filters. So tunable optical filters is nothing but these filters are going to be tunable by at least one branch of the interferometric filter there. So we are going to use an interferometric filter which is going to have the propagation length or the refractive index is going to be altered by the control mechanism there. So when these parameters change, that is when the propagation length or the refractive index change, the phase of the propagating light wave will also change. So when the phase of the propagating light wave changes, the intensity of the light signal will also change. So because the intensity is going to be directly proportional, is going to be a function of the wavelength there. So here in this case, your wavelength selectivity is going to be achieved. So when I'm going to operate this tunable optical filters over a frequency range del V, we will be able to tune the optical filter to one particular optical frequency band to pass through there. So you can see the circuit here. This is a tunable optical filter. We are going to have optical input frequencies, where this del V is going to be the optical frequency range, and this del V is nothing but the channel spacing. When these signals are going to be sent, this tunable optical filters is going to be controlled by the control signals, that is your tuning control. The tuning control can be either electrical or it can be thermal. So here I'm going to have the filter transfer function. So this is going to be tuned to a particular frequency there. So when this tunable optical filter is going to be tuned to a particular frequency, the output of this tunable optical filter, I'll be having a single optical output frequency there. So here to get the single optical output frequency, I'll be using a tunable optical filter there. So the two key technologies which is going to be used for this tunable filter are MEMS based and Bragg grating based devices. That is two technologies, one is MEMS based and other one is a Bragg grating based technologies there. So your MEMS actuated filters, these actuated filters are going to be advantageous because we are able to tune to a wide range, and then that flexibility of the design is also possible in using this MEMS actuated filters there. So the tunable filter considerations, if I'm going to see, the tuning range is going to be around 25 terahertz for the whole 1330 nanometer to 1500 nanometer. So with EDF8 is going to be del lambda is going to be 35 nanometer, which is centered around 1550 nanometers. The channel spacing, if I'm going to see, the minimum separation that is going to be between the selected channels to minimize the crosstalk. Maximum number of channels can be given as n is equivalent to del V, that is the overall frequency range divided by the channel spacing there. And next is the tuning speed. Tuning speed is depends upon how fast the switching needs to be done. Usually it will be in the range of milliseconds. So the next active devices is going to be your optical add or drop MUX, that is your OADM. So here in this case, where we are going to use this is to add or drop the wavelengths to the DWDM systems. We will be using this optical add or drop MUX there. So here we are going to have multiple tunable filter gratings are going to be used in conjunction with your circulators there. So in this example, we are going to use two optical circulators. These two optical circulators along with this tunable filter grating, we can add or drop any number of n channel, n different wavelengths there. So for this example, I'm going to take a circulator in combination with a tunable filter fiber grating. So to this circulator, we know that circulator is going to pass the signal in only one direction there. So the circulator is going to have the input signal wavelengths from lambda 1 to lambda n. And this demultiplexer from here, the signal is going to travel like this. When it is going to flow from port 1 to port 2, when the channels here, because of this Bragg grating conditions, are not going to be satisfied for the wavelengths lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. In that case, these wavelengths will be reflected back and we will be getting it out at the output of your demultiplexer there. That means that these wavelengths are going to be dropped. Similarly, if I am going to see, once the required wavelengths are going to be sent, that is your lambda 1 to lambda n, except lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, all these are going to be sent through your tunable filter gratings there. So in this case, this it will pass, all these wavelengths will pass and it will flow through the circulator. So here in this case, we are going to have a multiplexer. I want to add all these three signals, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 at the receiver side, which is going to be given through your multiplexer. So these signals is going to be added with the signals that is going to come from the input, say, transmitter side, and the total output which I am going to get at the output of your port 2 is lambda 1 to lambda n. So here in this case, we are dropping off the wavelengths, and in this case, we are going to add the wavelengths there. So the examples of your active devices are nothing but, we are going to have a tunable filter, where this tunable filter can be selected to select a narrow spectral band with a much wider optical band there. So here your optical add or drop multiplexer, we are going to insert, that is add or extract, drop the wavelengths at the designated port. So suppose I am going to take this as your multiplexer, where I am going to have 4 input ports and 4 output ports. So I am going to have a mirror at your wavelength 3. So at the wavelength 3, when I am going to have a mirror, whatever light I am going to get, the wavelength I am going to get, that is not going to be passed through the multiplexer and you will not be getting it, so that will be reflected back. So here in this case, that lambda 3 wavelength will be gone through your port 2D, it will not be reached. So suppose if I want the lambda 3 wavelength to be got at the output, in that case, using your port 2A, I will add it to the mirror so that this mirror will reflect that lambda 3 and I will be getting it at the output. So here in this case, I am going to drop the lambda 3. In this case, I am going to add the lambda 3 by using a reflecting mirror along the path of your light travel there. So here, next is your dynamic gain equalizer. So the dynamic gain equalizer, what we are going to see is, we are going to have, to the dynamic gain equalizer, we are going to have the inputs where the output wavelength amplitudes from an EDFA, that is a erbium doped fiber amplifier, is going to be got. So when I'm going to see, the output wavelengths are not going to have a constant amplitude, we are going to have a varying amplitude there. So these varying amplitude, I have to make it equal. So for that, I'll be using a dynamic gain equalizer there. So when I send these wavelengths to the dynamic gain equalizer, my output wavelength amplitudes are going to be same. That is, it is going to be equalized. So here we are going to use this dynamic gain equalizer to reduce the attenuation of the individual wavelengths within the spectral band there. So the other name for a dynamic gain equalizer is dynamic channel equalizer, or it is dynamic spectral equalizer. So the function is to filter out the individual wavelengths and equalize the gain on a channel by channel basis there. So the applications of this dynamic channel gain equalizer is flattening the non-linear gain profile. So since it is varying, this non-linear gain profile should be flattened for an optical operational amplifier there. And we can be used for compensation of the variation in your transmission losses that is going to occur on individual channels across a spectral band within the link, and we can attenuate, add or drop the selective wavelengths. Polarization controller, the other device is your polarization controller, where it is going to be used for high speed real time polarization control in a closed loop system there. So where we are going to have a polarization center and a control logic is going to be present in the closed loop system there. So the purpose is the device is going to adjust the incoming state of the polarization to an arbitrarily output state of your polarization. So the polarization control will adjust the state of the polarization there. So the applications of the polarization controller are going to include your mode, polarization mode dispersion, compensation polarization, scrambling and polarization mix multiplexing. Next is, next active component is a chromatic dispersion compensators. So chromatic dispersion compensators is, as the data rate in the optical fiber is going to be about 2.5 gigabits per second, due to chromatic dispersion, it is going to cause the pulse broadening, which is going to lead to bitrate error there. So in that case, what I have to do is, I have to implement a dispersion compensating fiber should be used. So here in this case, the dispersion compensating fiber is going to be used over a wide spectral range, and this can be done by fine tuning there. So that means that the fine tuning can be done by means of a tunable dispersion compensator. So where this dispersion compensator is going to work over a narrow spectral band to correct any residual or variable dispersion. If there is going to be any dispersion, that dispersion should be corrected by a tunable dispersion compensator there. So this is going, this device for achieving this is nothing but the dispersion compensator module, where this dispersion compensator module can be operated manually, remotely or dynamically. So if I'm going to go for manual tuning, it is going to be done by the human operator there. So if I'm going to go for remote tuning is going to be your network management software is going to be adjusted remotely from a central management console. That is going to be done by a human network operator there. So dynamic tuning is the module itself will adjust without any human intervention. So you can see that when I am going to send a incident spectrum, when the incident spectrum is going to send through the optical fiber, there are going to be different gratings there. So the different gratings are going to have the different spacings. So when the different spacings are going to be there, as the spacing is going to decrease, the Bragg wavelength is going to decrease. That means that with a chirped fiber grating, this spacing, the gratings that are going to be present inside the fiber is going to be called as chirped fiber grating there. So when the shorter wavelength will travel deeply inside the fiber before getting reflected back towards the input side there, so which is going to experience more delays. So we can say that the relative delay is going to be by grating on the different frequency components, what I'm going to have is going to be opposite to the delays caused by the optical fiber there. So here there is nothing but a dispersion compensation where it is going to compress the pulse. So this is your widened pulse, this is the incident spectrum. When this incident spectrum is going to be sent through the optical fiber, because of this decreased grating spacing, your wavelength, that is the shorter wavelengths, will get reflected back and it is going to have a compressed pulse there. So the tunable light sources are nothing but the wavelength tuning of the laser can be done either by temperature or current variations there. So here we can design a wavelength tunable laser there. The frequency locking, so in the laser we are going to lock the frequency to a particular lasing mode, that is nothing but Fabry-Perot laser there. So here we are going to use spectral slicing, where spectral slicing is going to be of fixed or tunable narrowband optical filter. Here in this case, the frequency tuning can be achieved either by changing the temperature of the device or by altering the injection current into the active section or passive section there. So we can change the refractive index, which is going to cause a shift in the peak output wavelength. The maximum tuning range is going to depend on the optical output power, with larger output level resulting in a narrower tuning range. So this is your tunable, electric bed laser, DBR laser, where this tuning is going to be achieved by changing the temperature or altering the injection current. So this is going to be the channel spacing. The channel spacing should be 10 times the peak of this signal there, so spectral bandwidth there. So here in this case, if it is 10 times, then crosstalk can be avoided. This is the characteristics of your laser. Thank you.